Good afternoon. My name is Andrew Rivas. I'm the United States Postal Inspector, and I've been invited to talk about dangerous mail and basically mail security today. So I work for the United States Postal Inspection Service, and we are a federal agency that's independent. We're federal agents. There's 1,450 of us nationwide, a few overseas at military bases. We do have a uniform division of about 500 patrol officers. They work in the bigger cities, and they patrol, they escort expensive mail, things like that. And we are funded by the Postal Service. They fund us, but we're independent of them. So our job is to protect the Postal Service, its employees and customers from criminal attacks, protect the nation's mail system from criminal misuse. So right after the anthrax, right after 9/11, they had the anthrax attacks. And can anybody here remember what was going on? It was panic, right? People saw white powder. They were calling 911. First thing they saw white powder, could be a donut spill. They were calling 911, right? It happened with the Postal Service too. So can you imagine the post office where all the mail comes from here and goes to Phoenix? That's where our central plant is, and it's all processed there and goes to the rest of the world, right? We have 1,000 employees per shift working there. If can you imagine when they call 911, locals come and evacuate the place, nobody gets mail for the day, right? It took about 2 weeks of that happening throughout the country for the Postal Service to realize we can't deal with this because nobody's getting their mail. So they took initially a couple hundred of us, sent us to hazmat training, bomb training, and then they bought us a whole bunch of expensive equipment, and we're the ones that respond now. So the Postal Service, whenever they get any kind of incident, they're not allowed to call 911, they have to call me first. Because I go in there and I deal with it, identify it, deal with it, neutralize it, and I do it discreetly and I don't evacuate most of the time. But there are occasions when I do evacuate, and I'll tell you about some of them. So we've been trained to deal with hazardous waste operations, emergency response, forensic sampling. Most of us have scientific backgrounds that do it. And we deal with bombs and post-blast. And what's unique about us as opposed to other responders, if I respond to an incident and it's actually a threat and not a hoax, if it's a threat or it's a real bomb or something like that, I identify it, I clear it, and then I investigate it and I prosecute it all the way through the court system until they're in prison. All right. So just some numbers, 203 billion pieces of mail a year. I think we're around 500,000, but we still have the largest federal workforce in the United States. Who here can tell me what private company in the United States is the largest employer? We're second to them.
Walmart?
Yes. So Walmart, they're the only ones that hire more people than we do, right? We're the largest federal employer. We have a lot of facilities. Our facilities are shrinking down because we are selling them off little by little. We have the largest fleet of vehicles and a lot of customers. My jurisdiction comes from title, in this title of the Organized Crime Act, regulating explosives. I investigate all mail bombs that are directed at an individual. If a mail bomb is directed at a, let's say somebody sent a mail bomb to one of your judges and it's coming from a sovereign citizen group. All right, that's an act of terrorism, domestic terrorism. Who would be responsible for investigating that? What do you think would be
here?
Yeah, the FBI. So if it's terrorism related, they have primary. If it's individual going through the mail, it's my jurisdiction. It doesn't really mean a lot. We work together. All bomb cases, I usually get as much help as I can. It's just a matter of who has primary over. There's 200 federal laws that I have that I can use. Mail fraud's the biggest one, external mail theft. I have a lot of that. Last year, we had a lot going on between Kaja and Snowflake. Identity theft, postal burglaries, robberies. I get burglaries in Navajo County, mostly on the reservation. I just had them 2 weeks ago down in Loop. Other than that, we haven't really had any. The armed robberies we have, I don't think there's been any in Navajo County postal facilities I know. Maybe before my time, but revenue investigations, I get involved in that with people trying to rip us off. I do revenue work as well, companies, individuals. Drugs in the mail, I get a few, and then child pornography in the mail. So, talk about bombs. This is an actual mailbox that was blown up here in northern Arizona, but it wasn't a bomb that blew that up. What do you guys think it was?
Dry ice bomb.
Absolutely. You know a lot about that. You built it before, haven't you?
No, but I've been around
Yeah, so have I. I've heard about it, but I don't really.
It's an overpressurization device, is what we call it. It's not classified under state law or federal laws as an explosive device. It's an overpressurization. However, that's steel, and the door went across the street and actually, you know, took a chunk out of the steel door in business. So imagine if they hit a person, you know, that'd be deadly. Right, happens. These came through in 2011. There was a series of them that came from Yemen. Al-Qaeda was sending these to government agencies throughout the United States. And these were actually incendiary devices. I throw this up here because, you know, does that look like what you expect a mail bomb to look like? All right, so keep an open mind when you're, you know, looking at this stuff and
screening the mail.
They all did ignite, and we actually had one ignite inside of our facility at Maryfield, Virginia. So they all did go off. So I'm going to tell you about the screening that the Postal Service does before the mail gets to you guys, all right? There's basically three levels of screening that we do. When you guys go to the post office to drop off a parcel, what do they ask you? They ask you security questions, right? And if it's over a certain amount of weight, you drop off in the collection box, it's not going to go white air, it's going to go white brand, right? We train the employees to ask those questions, and we give them, you know, things that they should look for, the eyes, you know, and if they think they're lying, they put it off to the side and I deal with it. Level one. Later on, I'm going to talk about our processing plants have equipment in place to screen for toxins. And then what's the last step? It's when your carrier is delivering a piece of mail. He's the last chain. If something doesn't look right, he knows to put it aside and contact us. Okay. Also, international mail comes in from different parts of the world into locations in the United States. There's, at any given time, if you go to one of these facilities, there's a conveyor belt as big as this room, probably 50 agents on each side of Customs and Border Patrol. They got dogs that run up and down the conveyor belt. They're screening all the international stuff, but does it all get by? Do they get everything? No. You know, they didn't catch these. All right, so some stuff does get through. That's even before it gets to you guys. This is a real mail bomb. It was recovered from one of our most famous, infamous mail bombers. It was currently housed at Supermax. Ted Kaczynski, yes. I think he killed seven people, and he had a PhD in physics or something like that. He's a smart guy, but it was anti-government. That's the actual manifesto. He asked one of the media to publish it. They published it, and that's how they found the guy, because his brother read it and realized who it was. And unfortunately, he took it several months before he notified authorities, and it did kill another person in the meantime. But that's the actual device that Kaczynski built. So mail bombs can come in any shape or size, right? This one, is one that I actually worked myself a few months ago, not too long ago. But what's unique about that? It's coming from Iraq. Well, that part of Iraq is under ISIS control right now. And this guy, Frank, he is a retired quite a long time ago. He's a retired Green Beret, Special Operations operator. And he served during Desert Storm 1. And the only way to figure is they got a hold of some files because there were other operators throughout the United States that got the same mailings. And these were sent from ISIS. All right, so it happens. This went to Williams, Arizona.
Wow.
So this made it past CBP. It made it past the Postal Service, and it got delivered to his house.
There's an ongoing investigation. This is the Catholic school in Flagstaff. And their principal has been getting threatening letters for quite a while now.
This case, 2009, Pine Top, Arizona. I was working, and I get a call. You guys were getting a bunch of explosions occurring down Pine Top Lakeside, all the way down towards the reservation, and a little bit in Sholem. Somebody was blowing up trees. They like blowing up trees for some reason. They were blowing up other stuff. I got involved because they blew up a mailbox one day, so they called me up, and I hooked up with one of your detectives. Really didn't have any clues. We gathered all the pipe bombs, probably 11 of them that we recovered after they go off. The guy was blowing stuff in the middle of the night. Not really damaging a whole lot of stuff, just, you know, but who knows what he was capable of. So we started gathering all the evidence. Didn't have nothing to really go on. Put a report out there, didn't get any leads. So finally we got a list of everybody that had been arrested over a 10-year period for anything having to do with explosives. And for 2 weeks, we just started knocking on doors. me and this detective. And the second week, we were tired of it, you know, and it's getting old, and we walked up to this guy's house, and I look over and I see a cinder block with an outline of blue paint, you know, and it matched that. And this guy was painting all his bombs metallic blue from, it was actually car paint. And so that was the guy. We did a search, we backed off, you know, that's a clue. We backed off, we got a search warrant, Sholo did the search warrant, the SWAT team hit the house, and he was our guy, so that was a bomb because we had out there. Was it really a mail bomb? No, he was blown from mailboxes. It wasn't mail, it was a place device, but nonetheless. You got 10 years in prison for that, this guy.
Can dangerous mail be just bombs?
No.
No. That's a rattlesnake. This story that near the border of Colorado and Albuquerque, I get a call, and it was an attorney, and he didn't want to open the box. It smelled really bad. I went out there and ran tests on it. I did a bio test on it, air samples, radiation, nothing, and I x-rayed it. And I knew it was organic because nothing came up in the x-ray, but I thought it was feces, to be honest with you, when I looked at it and I opened it up. And you know, it was stinky because he'd been in there for 3 days, and I woke him up when I opened up the box.
Ooh.
But you know, it was his ex-wife that sent that to him.
This was a bomb that I worked in Alaska a long time ago, maybe 27 years ago. It was fatal. Look how small it is. Does that look like a mail bomb?
No.
Yeah, it killed the father of the intended recipient of his son. And it not only killed him, but it blew up. And, I mean, it was a two-story house, and it blew a hole right through the ceiling. And that was a low explosive. Very small parcel. And, you know, that looked like a bomb, does it? So, you know, people do stupid things. This was last year, somebody went up and down the street. We have had a carrier somewhere else in the United States lose an arm by opening up a mailbox, and they had the Coke bottle, you know, the oral pressurization device in there. And it wasn't enough pressure to go off, but when she rattled it, it mixed her a little more, and she lost an arm. And so our employees get scared when they see this stuff, so I take it seriously. And trust me, if I would have found out who did this, I would have charged him with something. So I'm going to talk about this one. This is the last mail bomb case I've worked, and hopefully the last before I retire. Joe Arpaio, if you were to get this parcel, what stands out?
Stamps.
Stamps, right? Do you see stamps in that kind of mail? It's pretty rare. They do make a stamp for it. What else is a big deal? I mean, what do you see here and there? What's the difference between the two? Yeah, who does that? Who mails a parcel? Who has ever here mailed a parcel where you tape something on one and hand it? Why would you do that? Wouldn't that stand out? Why are they doing that? There's a reason why you did that. So those two things would stand out for me. This really doesn't apply if you guys receive it, but this was mailed. It was discovered in between the Grand Canyon and Flagstaff. It's coming from California, going to Sheriff Joe Arpaio in Phoenix. And if you got this in your office and you're not sure about it, what would be the very first thing that you can do to resolve this?
Contact the seller.
Sender, absolutely, right?
Yeah.
Within the first 5 minutes, I called Mr. Stewart and I said, Mr. Stewart, this is Postal Inspector Rivas on my Flagstaff. I got a parcel sitting in front of me with your address on it, going to Sheriff Joe Arpaio. Did you send it? And his exact words were, I did not send it, but I can tell you who did. And he gave me the name of the suspect. And he told me this elaborate story how this guy's been trying to frame him for years and doing all kinds of stuff and turning him into the FBI as a terrorist, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, from then on, we knew who our suspect was. We just had to build a case, right? And just the background on it, Mr. Stewart is a multimillionaire, owns a huge publishing company. He had a business relationship with the suspect. So the suspect wants to write books on how to play the stock market based on the stars. Stewart published it. Then he was going to write another one, and Stewart said, this is junk, I'm not going to do any more. And then he started a pattern of sending him mailings, threats. Then he started calling the FBI and turning him as a terrorist, just doing a bunch of different stuff. Finally, it escalated to the point where he sent a real bomb. So that's kind of the background, how it all started. Arpaio had nothing to do with it. I think just because Arpaio was in the news a lot. So this was where he mailed it at. I throw this in here just so you can get an idea how we investigate these cases. You know, we're looking for late prints, tire tracks, DNA samples we actually got. And how many crime scenes on a mail bomb case do you think we're working?
For when it's like for this one?
Yeah, where did they meld?
Where did they meld it? Okay.
Where they
melded to? Exactly. So that's two. And where's the third
one? Post office where it was.
Well, where he built it. Where I want to find out where he built the bomb, right? Crime scene right here where it was built at. The other crime scene was right here where I detonated it. And then where he built it, right? So this was after I got the call at 4:30, went and ran some tests on it. I did the radiation, I did bioterror test, I did the air test. It did have a little substance leaking out of it, and I tested it on my infrared spectrometer, which is a mobile laboratory, and I determined the right way that it was Hodgkin's 100B, which is a very potent type of black powder. And then I x-rayed it, and I knew, you know, I knew we had a bomb. This was the x-ray I took of the actual device. There's the micro switch, and those boxes, you guys, have you ever opened them up? You know, there's a string on there, nylon. So the idea was it was attached to that. You can actually see where he attached it right there. And when you open it up, it would open up the circuit to this D-size battery, which is very unique. We normally see 9-volt batteries. Any of you guys have kids that play with rocket engines, rocket motors? Yeah. So there's the little Estes rocket igniter right there. The X-ray didn't pick up the actual material around it. It ignites, but that's what was going to set off when the power was in here. And like Kaczynski, he had his manifesto inside there. Here's a reconstruction of it right here. What we're theorizing is where he had it armed, which was very dangerous, meaning he drove this bomb all the way from Oklahoma, all the way to drop it off and drove back, and he was back home in 22 hours. So that bomb was sitting in the back of his car armed that whole time. Yeah, but it was very well built. That was a place very stout, so they obviously had no confidence. If I built a bomb, I would not have enough confidence to drive across the country with a bomb in the back of the car. And what I could tell you about this bomb, when we tested it, if it were sitting here in this room, it would kill all of us. It was a very, very powerful device. You know, our pilot doesn't open up his own mail, nor he did. It probably would have killed his secretary had it made its way to him. I'm confident it would have made its way to him.
Law enforcement officials in Arizona said today a package sent to the high-profile and controversial Sheriff Joe Arpaio would have exploded and caused serious injury or killed someone if it had been opened, but an alert mail carrier noticed something wrong and flagged it for inspection. Arpaio is fond of calling himself the toughest sheriff in America, told reporters today he's concerned about his family's safety and added, "I didn't ask for all these threats."
It was a lot of work, I can tell you that. It pretty much consumed my life for 17 months because I had to prove it. And this guy paid for cash. The thing that broke the case open was he was driving from Jay, Oklahoma, and he pretty much was on empty when he got to Tulsa. And he went to a gas station. We got him on video. And the gas station was closed. It was a twin bar, so he had to use an ATM card. He couldn't go anywhere else. And that's when I got his records, and we saw that's what broke the case wide open. And then we started from Amarillo all the way to Flagstaff. We pulled video of every source. We could, hundreds of sources, we pulled video to get him. We actually got three locations where we've got him on video on a timeline driving past that area. And so we tracked him. And the nearest video we got was a snowball of him, which was a mile and three quarters away from where he deposited the piece. So that's what we hope. Okay, so we used DNA. The trial was 13 days, 28 witnesses, and it took 3.5 hours for the jury to convict. Yeah, he got 8 years. And the reason, you know, we were hoping for more is it's a 20-year felony, but the reason is, you know, I don't agree with it, but they're saying it didn't hurt anybody because we intercepted it.
Anybody recall who did this, or you guys know the story about this? So briefly, I don't expect we'll ever see this again. This was weaponized anthrax. They traced it down to one of our laboratories in Utah, a federal laboratory. The guy that they suspect, they were getting ready to indict him. He was 2 weeks away from indictment, and he committed suicide. And he was a federal employee, so he's a scientist. Do I think anybody's ever gonna get a hold of this anthrax that's weaponized again? No. Can you make your own? Yes, but it's not gonna be anything like this. You know, just like the ricin we're seeing coming through. It's very raw and not as potent as something that would be weaponized. The Postal Service, this is more for the first responders, or if you guys ever come up on an accident scene, there's a lot of mail that goes between Chicago and Los Angeles.
a lot of businesses that want to send stuff cheaper, they'll ship it. I can't imagine, there's got to be 50 to 100 trucks a day going through. And every now and then they'll crash in between. And if it happens between Albuquerque and Needles, I have to respond on I-40. We do carry hazmat on our trucks. DPS knows to call me immediately on the first notification they make, and we have to respond. Our hazmat's always labeled like that. It's always a first on, last on, first off, just so you know. And I mentioned earlier that there's three levels of checks that the Postal Service does. One, when you first take it to the counter. The biggest thing is we installed biodetection systems. Every processing machine down in Phoenix has one. It detects anthrax. So the mail you guys get has been checked for anthrax, all right? We do have the capability of making adjustments on the machine to detect other stuff. So if Homeland Security calls us up and said, you know, there's a threat of ricin coming through from a certain country, we can make the adjustments as necessary. But there, so what I can tell you is, Postal Service does a lot to screen the mail before it gets to you guys. That's what the machine looks like. Once a year, we have to suit up for 2 days and go through and do exercises of actually recovering samples and cleaning machines. It's designed so that if the alarm goes off, we can know that the mail is within a mile, 1 mile radius. I take that back, a 1 hour radius. So we can be able to trace all the mail that left that plant within an hour to recover whatever piece was contaminated. This is the equipment I carry with me at all times. I carry an X-ray machine, one of the best there is. The Ludlum is one of the best radiation detectors out there. I have a Multi-Ray Pro, which is a more advanced system now. 2020 gene system, almost all firefighters have that. It's gonna check for a live virus. The problem with that is if there's yeast or bodybuilder's powder or something like that, some of these bad guys that send these threats out there know, and they'll put that stuff in there, because that'll set that off. And I've seen police officers or fire departments see that and evacuate and say, oh, we got anthrax here. No, you don't know that. All you know is you got something alive in there. The next step that I do is I go to my Gen Prime system, which nobody else has that, except for the State Patrol hazmat team carries that. And if I get an alarm on that, I'm gonna be running down the street as fast as I can in my BDS outfit, because that means it's a weaponized something bad and it can kill you, all right? I've never had that go off. I carry a saber, and that's the same thing that you guys get wanted by when you go through the TSA. And then my hazmat ID is my mobile laboratory. And the mobile laboratory, it's an infrared spectrometer. So what it does, I'll take a sample of the powder, I'll put it on there, more liquid, and it runs a beam of light through it. It has a database of probably a million stuff in there, and it compares that wavelength to the actual known stuff in the library, and it'll tell me what it is. So for example, I've had it tell me the date stuff's manufactured, who manufactured it, what lot it came from. You know, if I get some kind of soap powder, it'll tell me what it is, what brand it is. That's how accurate that thing is. For liquids, it breaks it down to three molecular levels. This is over in Phoenix. If something happens, I need help. That vehicle's always manned and geared up to respond. So if I get a call, if you guys ever call me, or if I get a call from the fire department, or I get calls from hazmat teams all the time asking for help, I ask them these questions, and then I take that information, I give it straight to my dispatch in DC, and they have a database. So a lot of these big companies, Procter & Gamble, I know, Johnson & Johnson, you name it, they, when they're getting ready to send something out, like a mass mailing of 5 million mailings of samples of talcum powder or something like that, they let the Postal Service know we upload that. And that way, if we get a hit on something like that, if it breaks open, we know about it. Just bear in mind, these are protocols that we recommend. You gotta go by whatever Navajo County tells you to do, okay? Just leave it where it's found, don't disturb it. Try not to clean up the substance, because I need a pretty good sizable sample to test. There have been cases where employees have spilled acid or something on their hands and it's actually burning and bubbling up. In that case, get medical attention right away. They don't call me first, right? Common sense. Instruct people in the media area to wash your hands with soap and water, or is open up with hot water, right? We don't want it to get inside your skin. but I want a list of everybody that was in contact with it, because I want to decontaminate them, right? Because what happens if I test it and it comes back to be ricin? Ricin could take, what, 72 hours to kill you? And, you know, so.
Cordoned off the area, shut your HVAC down. So you cordoned off the area, you know, that's what Postal Service does. They usually tape it off, depending on the severity. If it's a liquid and it's off-gassing, something noxious like acetone, they'll probably cordon off a pretty good area. Most of the time, I just have to carry it out to my hazmat locker. You know, it's something you got. Activate your local emergency action plan. That's why I keep stressing, you know, do what you guys should have an emergency action plan. I'm sure you do. Mailbombs. Obviously, don't open it, but remember, mailbombs are designed to explode and open. Just follow, you know, don't open it, don't move it, call, isolate the area, evacuate, and let the experts deal with it. If you need to get a hold of us, that's my number. It's a 24-hour dispatch in Washington, D.C. And if you got a suspicious mail piece, and you guys decide you want to call us for help first, you call that. If they can't get a hold of me, they're going to call Phoenix, and somebody will deal with it. So that's PowerPoint. It's 20 minutes, I think, video. It's real short, kind of wraps things up. It's more of the Hollywood version of what I just talked about.
Now, there are some important facts to remember about these types of incidents. Number one, these types of crimes are almost never random. Usually the perpetrator knows his intended victim and doesn't attempt to harm anyone else who handles the mail piece. Number two, the chances of ever being involved in an incident are less than one in billions. So when you're planning your response procedures, it's important to keep in mind that most calls will be false alarms or hoaxes. But threat hoaxes are also a crime, and normal evidence handling procedures should apply. Number three, U.S. postal inspectors work around the clock to ensure the safety of the mail, and they're always available to answer questions and provide advice. And we also have the specially trained and equipped teams in most major cities, and they can help you manage any incident involving the mail. Now, I'd like to show you a short video put together by the Inspection Service in the aftermath of the 2001 anthrax attack to address the needs of first responders who may have to respond to a suspicious mail incident. Now, in over 200 years of providing service to the nation, we've only experienced one event of this nature. But for U.S. Postal Inspectors, even one incident is too many. Lights, please.
Your paper is full of lies.
I don't care what he says. If the congressman wants this paper's support, then he needs to get behind this bill. We have no reason to compromise. I don't think I need to explain to you that it's pure common sense. And we have no reason to back down. Neil, I know it's an election year. This is something that our readers feel so strongly about. I don't think you want to alienate 20% of potential voters. Thanks, John. Okay, Neil, I need to clear my desk. Can we get together over lunch to discuss this again? Okay. Okay, call me. Bye.
Carmela! Carmela! strange safe.
For over 200 years, the males have been free of biological terror. All that changed with the anthrax letters of 2001 and the discovery of ricin in 2003. But despite these incidents, the mail remains one of the safest and most reliable services in American life. Over 200 billion pieces of mail are delivered each year, and the risk of receiving dangerous mail is very slight. In fact, the odds are about 1 in 100 billion. But the number of hoaxes requiring a response by postal inspectors, police, or first responders continues to number in the thousands each year. Usually, in an incident like this, local authorities are the first agency to respond. But whether the threat is real or imagined, the actions you take can save lives and preserve valuable evidence.
Dispatch 219, I'm 1023 at La Paz Publications.
Where's the letter with the powder?
It's down the hall in the editor's office.
Has anyone left the building since you've called?
No, no one's left, but we're about to go to lunch and there's going to be a lot of people leaving soon.
Oh, not today. Work with my supervisor and let's see if we can secure the perimeter. No one enters or leaves the building till we know what we got, okay? Also, have your maintenance staff turn off the ventilation. We don't want anything spread around the building. All right?
Okay.
Ma'am, I'm Officer Davidson. The fire department's on its way. Is everything okay here?
Yes, we're fine.
Where's the letter now?
It's in there on the desk. I closed the door so I could keep it from spreading.
Was anyone else in your office when you opened the letter?
No one.
Has anyone been in there since?
No. I called to my assistant to get help, but I told her to keep her distance.
I need you to step outside and go directly to the nearest bathroom. Wash your hands with soap and water, but don't touch your face. You understand?
Yes.
I need all of you to move to the far side of the floor. Everything's going to be fine. It's probably just a hoax, but let's be safe.
Up to this point, the officer has done everything correctly. In the unlikely event of a real attack with the toxic agent, one of the big issues is crowd control. People leaving the scene can spread contamination and complicate the investigation into the crime. If you're the first unit to respond to the scene, it's vital that you take steps to minimize movement within the affected area, isolate the suspicious package, and to preserve the crime scene. Get a list of names of anyone who has left the scene since the suspicious powder was discovered. Also check to see if anyone has removed items from the scene. It is usually necessary to test the suspicious substance on the scene to assess the threat to public health. While this action is vital, it's important to test only the smallest amount necessary and to take steps to ensure that the crime scene is not compromised. Most incidents of this nature will turn out to be hoaxes, usually conducted with common household agents like baby powder, cornstarch, and similar items. Others may be harmful agents, like pesticides or irritants. Though non-lethal, the item used is still evidence into a federal crime and could often help lead to a conviction. Postal inspectors have recently undergone specialized training that can allow them to quickly screen a suspicious powder or substance, often right on the spot. Calling postal inspectors early in an incident may help resolve incidents related to mailed items faster and reduce costs to your department. Postal inspectors are equipped with a 24-hour command center at headquarters. If a suspicious mail piece is discovered, it is vital that you contact them immediately. Make sure this number is displayed at your dispatch and call centers.
Yeah.
Miss Lopez. Hi. I'm Postal Inspector Alan Goddard. Can I ask you a few questions? Sorry you had to go through all this today. You know, the field test came back negative for anthrax and other toxins.
So there's no danger?
Probably not. But we'll need to run a few more comprehensive tests at the lab, just to be sure. We get a lot of hoax letters like this. Can you think of anyone who might want to hurt you?
We're a political newspaper. We upset our fair number of people. But no, I can't think of anyone who would want to go this far.
What about you personally?
Me? No one.
You ever received any other threats? Phone calls?
I got a call the other day from a guy who wants to deport all aliens, regardless of their status.
Really? When was that?
Thursday, I think.
We may need to pull your phone records. You have any objections to us going through the mailroom, talking to some other employees?
No.
Thanks, appreciate your help. You know, it's been a rough day. If you have any questions, you need anything else, just let us know, okay? Thanks a lot.
This anthrax will kill you now.
Pretty tight security here?
Yeah. Only the mail clerks have the code for this room.
Do you remember anything special about the letter Miss Lopez got?
No, it must have been pretty ordinary.
Why would you say that?
Part of our job is to look for anything that might be a problem. If a letter's too large, has a bulge, or maybe too much postage, we give packages an even harder look.
You had problems before?
No, but we've heard about other papers being attacked, so we try to be careful.
You wear gloves when sorting?
Yeah. They provide us with face masks, too, but we never bother with them. I might start, though.
All right, so what happened here when Miss Lopez found the letter?
Her assistant called down to tell us about the powder. We called 911, turned off the air conditioning, and made an announcement on the intercom telling people not to open their mail.
You did the right thing. We wish more mail rooms were this tight.
Postal inspectors train consistently to respond to hazardous mail. It's equally important that your staff become familiar with the characteristics of suspicious mail. In the case of letters, you should look for letters with excessive postage, misspelled addresses, letters addressed to people who no longer work at the building, or whose titles are wrong. But the signs are not always so obvious. Sometimes the letters are very professional looking, with computer-printed labels and metered postage. You should also look for letters with unusual return addresses, or none at all. Another clue is a postmark that doesn't match the return address. Sometimes the signs are even more obvious. For example, a letter that is leaking liquid or powder, has a bulge on one side, or seems to be unusually heavy. In addition to toxic threats, packages can also carry the risk of explosive devices. Again, the warning signs of a suspicious package are the same. Excessive postage, packages addressed to generic titles, such as editor or chief executive officer, or whose titles are wrong. They can all be clues. Unusual weights or sloshing sounds should also be a concern. In the past, these were reliable indicators of potential threats. But now we often see packages that also appear very professional. Look for unusual markings like open this end, do not x-ray, or confidential, personal 4. Mail bombs tend to be very personal attacks, usually aimed at one person. Excessive taping may also be suspicious. Bombers don't want their packages to come open in transit and often use more tape than necessary. If a package arrives that you are not expecting, attempt to verify it with the sender before you open it. Often a simple phone call can clear up the issue.
Evans.
Steve, it's Alan Goddard. Hey, what do you got for me on the threat letter?
We didn't have any luck pulling prints, Alan.
According to QD, the clippings are all from the February issue of a fishing magazine.
So not much there either. The handwriting on the envelope did tell us that your suspect is likely to be left-handed. And he's also someone who often prints his letters rather than writing in cursive. Now, Andrea's working on the powder. I think she has something for you there, too.
All right.
Hold on.
Goddard on three.
Alan?
Hey, Andrea. What do you got?
Well, we got the lab results
back on the powder, and
it turns out to be cornstarch.
Good, 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 good.
But we
did find a few things on the envelope that
might interest you. This guy
may be connected with horses. We found a couple of hairs in the envelope adhesive, and both of them
turned out to be equine.
Equine. So, we're looking for a guy who works at the track.
Well, and there's something else, too. We found some traces of black powder.
So?
Either this guy is into antique guns, or...
Or he's moving up to bombs.
Right.
Thanks, Andrew.
Come out here and look at a package.
Yeah, show them where it is.
Andrea's concerns turned out to be valid. A few days after the hoax letter, one of the carriers noticed a package addressed to the newspaper that didn't look right. The package turned out to contain a pipe bomb packed with black powder and nails. If it had exploded, half the office might have been destroyed. The lab examined the bomb and found more horsehair. No fingerprints were left behind, but the handwriting and postmark would prove useful in our investigation. While waiting on more tests, I went to break the news to Soma Lopez.
A bomb? Oh my God.
Look, I've already spoken to your mailroom staff. They're gonna be even more careful until we nail this guy. I got a portable X-ray machine at the post office. I'm gonna screen every package that's addressed to your offices. Are you certain? Are you certain you can't think of anyone who might have a personal grudge against you?
No, I can't. But the letter sounded so much like someone was upset with something we'd written in the paper.
I gotta tell you, I think this guy is just trying to throw us off. Look at the language of the threat. I mean, he refers to you in some very personal terms. It's just a hunch. I think this guy is somebody you know.
But I can't imagine anyone that I know being capable of killing me.
Do me a favor, just check to see if anyone was out of work on this date. Okay. And also on the date the package would have arrived.
Can I ask why?
Yeah, the postmark. The postmark on the package tells us that this bomb was mailed from a town about 150 miles from here. Also tells us when it was mailed. This is a pretty powerful explosive. I can't imagine the bomber's going to want to be at work the day it arrives.
Are you suggesting you think someone here was involved?
Ms. Lopez, at this point I don't have any good suspects. I'm not ruling anybody out, either.
I'll have my assistant get you that information.
One other thing. Do you know if any of your employees own horses? The round date postmark told us that the package had been received at a small post office about 3 hours away. Since the postmaster didn't remember receiving any packages over the counter that day, she suggested it might have been dropped off at a commercial mail receiving agency. It's a fancy title for one of those neighborhood shipping centers. There was only one nearby. I'm Postal Inspector Alan Goddard. I need to speak with you about a package that may have been mailed from here about a week ago. Can you tell me who would have been working on the morning of April 14th?
Sure. I was. It was the day before the tax deadline, so we were really busy. But we didn't get many packages that day.
Does this package look familiar to you? Would have been about this big.
Mm-hmm. I remember because it had a lot of tape on one side.
Any chance that one of the people in this photo may have dropped that package off?
Yeah. This guy. I'm sure of it. I remember because he had a coat on, and it was over 70 outside. I teased him about it, but he didn't seem to think it was funny. Why, did this guy do something wrong?
Yeah. Yeah, he should have watched more reruns. Yeah, I forgot that some horses can talk.
Please search for it, open up!
LaPaz Publications.
This is Postal Inspector Alan Goddard. I need to speak to security now.
This is Security Inspector.
I'm looking for one of your copy chiefs, Jeff Cacker. Is he at work today?
Yes, sir, he is. Mr. Cacker
usually comes in every Saturday.
Is there something wrong?
No, listen. Don't even tell him I called. We just need to get a statement. You understand?
Yes, sir. Should I notify Ms.
Lopez?
No, we'll call her on the way. Just sit tight. Siegel, DeMarco, you're with me. Cacker's at his office.
Like the pieces of a puzzle, sometimes things just seem to fit. Only 4 employees had missed work on the day the package was mailed. And of those, only one owned a horse. It turned out that Soma Lopez and Jeff Cacker had dated for a while. When she got promoted to editor, he didn't take it too well. When she broke it off, he took it personal. Very personal.
He's still here?
Yes, he is.
Where is he?
He's down the hall. You can't go in there.
Just hold tight.
What the hell is this?
Cacker, I'm Postal Inspector Alan Goddard. You're under arrest.
What? What the hell for?
Come out of here.
Jeff Cacker received a sentence of 20 years in federal prison for his crimes. But if it hadn't been for a solid investigation, crack forensics, and an alert postal employee, the results of this case could have been tragic. Further information is available from a variety of sources, including the Centers for Disease Control and on our website at usps.com/postal inspectors. Remember, the risk of ever being exposed to dangerous mail is very low. But by taking a few simple precautions, you can reduce the odds even more.
Can we have house lights, please? Now, the film you've just seen lays out our recommended procedures for responding to suspicious mail incidents. If you receive a call of this nature, it's important that you alert the U.S. Postal Inspection Service quickly. Make sure our toll-free response number is posted at your dispatch center and 911 call centers. Now, involving postal inspectors quickly can often help to resolve the incident without the need for a larger response. And this helps reduce costs to your department, and it reduces the impact on citizens. Now, we're here to assist you in any way we can. Additional copies of the film you've seen, they're available to help you with your training efforts. Just see me after the seminar. Now, remember, the chances of encountering a dangerous piece are less than 1 in billions, so it's important to base your procedures around the very low probability of ever having an actual incident. Balance your responsibility to protect the public with reasonable means to protect evidence of criminal threats. The U.S. Postal Inspection Service will continue to strive to make the mail the most reliable and safe method of delivery in the world. Questions? Yes.